Okay, today we're going to start a really big discussion, and it probably won't end today, but at least we'll get started. And I call it Video 2.0. That's because we're about to enter the second iteration of the video revolution. The first video revolution was the one where we all picked up video cameras and of late phones, and we started to shoot video and put it up on YouTube and Facebook and stuff like that. And everybody thought, wow, now I'm a videographer, now I'm a filmmaker, now I'm going to make a fortune. And as it turned out, most people didn't make anything. If you saw the news we did this morning, 99% of the people on Facebook make less than $100, on YouTube make less than $100 a year, and 90% make less than $2.50 a month. So this is not a way to make a living, obviously. So a lot of people now who were so enthralled with the idea of I'm going to take my phone and I'm going to take my camera and I'm going to start making videos, and they're all sitting around going, what happened? What happened was a consequence of the impact of technology. It's this disruptive technology. It's called disruptive for a reason, because it's disrupting anything. So let's get down to the meat of the issue is, how do I make a living with the video camera, and what happened to my YouTube channel that I'm not making $1 million? Okay, let's go back to the beginning. Many, many years ago, like 1988, which is before most people were born probably, I was a producer at CBS, and I quit and I bought a little video camera. I started to travel around the world and make videos, and I went to war zones and I went to Cambodia with the Khmer Rouge and all that stuff. And in those days, I could sell my pieces for $25,000 per piece. That's a lot of money for a piece of video. And the reason I could sell it so much was because I was in a competitive position. My only competition was, you know, network crews that cost 10 times what I did. So for 25,000 bucks, the network thought they were getting a pretty good deal. But of course, as years went by, then I was the only, John Alpert and I were the only people doing this, and he worked for NBC. So I was really by myself. And so any place I went, if I could get a reasonable story, I could charge just a little bit below what the network would cost. And as long as the quality was as good, people would pay me. So it was a great way to make a living then. It's not a great way to make a living now. And everybody's sort of upset about that. And they go, what happened? Well, what happened was, of course, as this opportunity opened up, millions, quite literally millions of people streamed in and also picked up video cameras or phones. And they started making video and they started putting it online. And then, of course, the number of platforms expanded because you got YouTube and you got Facebook. And now everybody and their brother makes video all day long. And you know what? It's not worth anything. I'm sorry to tell you that, but you know, your video, it's just not worth anything. Yeah, I know there's the person who, you know, is a decider or influential person on, you heard a story about someone who made $1 million last year on YouTube. You're better off going to buy a lottery ticket because you'll do better with that. So that was video 1.0. That was the beginning of the video revolution. We went from zero people having video cameras, except for the VHS that your grandfather had to take pictures of your bar mitzvah. And now we're in the world of video 1.0, where suddenly everybody starts to shoot video, and the market is essentially flooded with, 99% of it is crap, but it's just flooded with crap, and there's no value attached to it. Well, now, how do we move from there to actually being able to make a living in this new world of everybody having a video camera? That's the secret to this whole thing. The answer to that, and I hate to get too historical here, the answer to that is to look back at other examples of what happened when technology turned over societies and we went from nobody being able to do something to everybody being able to do something. This happens all the time. The first cars that were made, they cost a fortune for what cars were then, and hardly anybody had cars. And so when Henry Ford started to mass produce cars, well, the price of cars dropped to essentially $500, I think, for a Model T, which meant that everybody could have a car. So it wasn't such a rarity to have a car anymore. It's not such a rarity to have a video camera. In fact, who doesn't have a video and who doesn't shoot video? The best example historically that I can give you for this is the invention of the printing press, because that was an example where the control of media was in the hands of very, very few people, just like it used to be with ABC and NBC and CNN and stuff like that. And then this piece of technology come along and suddenly everybody started making books. Before the printing press was invented, books were made, you know, by hand, by scribes, and guys who were scribes, they made a fortune just writing stuff down, and there weren't that many books in the whole world that just didn't exist. after the printing press, like 20 years after the printing press, there are 15 million books in Europe. So the value of the book collapses. And that's what makes the book industry work, is that suddenly everybody can afford to buy books. And on the other hand, the guys who are the scribes and stuff like that, the monks, they're driven out of business because nobody really interested in their skill set anymore. And I'm sure they were is traumatized, and they understand what happened, just like the guy running around with his iPhone, you know, out in Manhattan goes, I understand, I got this fantastic thing I shot in Times Square, and I can't make any money at it. Well, big surprise. So what happened with the books, this sort of printing 2.0, was that you got this explosion of people making books and writing books and publishing books, and the architecture of the world of books wasn't really prepared for it, because nobody, there were no bookstores, there was no Barnes and Noble, there was no Random House, there were no publishers, there were no agents, there was nothing. And so for about 30 years, you get this shakedown at the end of the 15th century, in which the world is flooded with these books and nobody knows what the hell to do with them and nobody can make a living. And to show you how bad it is, a lot of people go, oh, Gutenberg invented the printing press. Gutenberg was not Bill Gates. Gutenberg ended bankrupt because the architecture of the business to support this explosion from zero books to 15 million books wasn't in place. Well, the architecture to support the explosion of zero videos to a billion videos also is not yet in place. YouTube is bullshit, I'm sorry. I mean, it's a nice place to put your stuff up for free, but you're never gonna make a living on YouTube, on your YouTube channels, unless, you know, it's a fluke, and the few people who do it. 500 hours uploaded every minute, it's flooded. And so maybe one guy out of a billion is making a couple of bucks out of this thing. So you can forget about YouTube as a way to make money. And Facebook, even worse. The only person making money out of your video on Facebook is Mark Zuckerberg, which is kind of messed up. So what happens to make this a viable thing? So first, let's be honest. Everybody and their brother knows how to write, right? That's what you went to school for. You learned how to write. And probably if I look out in the street in Manhattan, there's 9 million people who are writing their novel, and 99% of them suck, and they're never going to make a living out of it. That's fine. They may go to a party and say, I'm a writer, but they suck. But occasionally you get a guy, you know, who writes a great novel and they can make a fortune. The reason is because they write something that people are interested in, but also there's an architecture that is designed to carry their content to the public and make it commercially viable. And this involves agents, it involves publishing houses, it involves bookstores, it involves books reviews. I mean, we've had 500 years to architect this kind of environment in which qualified and talented writers can survive and thrive. We have to do the same thing with video. We have to create an architecture that takes us from the sole operator running around with his video camera, making something great, and that's probably like maybe 1% or 0.1% of the people making video, which is fine, that's great. It's just like being an artist. Some people can do it, most people suck, but they still try. So we have to have an architecture that takes us from the one talented person with the video camera making something, that nurtures that, that takes care of that, that is an agent. We need a kind of a video agency, and that doesn't exist yet. Someone who can pluck out qualified great work and say, this is worth doing, and then can plug it into a system that is prepared to pay for it, and that would be publishing houses. Right now, we don't have video publishing houses. We have networks that produce their own stuff, their producers, but there is nobody who is in the publishing business that essentially packages the video and takes it out into a market that is prepared for it and is prepared to pay for it. So how do you create that? You have to create an environment in which there is advertising that is married to the product per se. In other words, that people will pay for advertising attached to that specific piece of video, or pay for that piece of video in and of itself. This is a big project to create this kind of thing, and it is not going to happen overnight. So you're sitting there going, well, that's great, but I got to pay the rent next Tuesday, and this doesn't do me any good, this kind of theoretical conversation. This will arise because the content is there and the appetite is there. It just has to be connected. In the meantime, if you're in the business, how do you make a living right now? Well, I'll tell you one thing. You are not going to make a living in the news business, because that is flooded. There's a million people there, and you're probably not going to make a living going to work for some, you know, online news thing, because news has no money attached to it. The place you'll make money now with your iPhone or your smartphone is in kind of filling a competitive gap. So when I went out with my little video camera 30 years ago, I was competing against network crews that were charging a fortune, and I was delivering a product that was just as good, more or less, but I could charge appreciably less, and that's why I got $25,000 per piece. Today, I couldn't get 25 cents per piece, probably, because that market is flooded. But let's look at the television video market per se. The biggest numbers now are in the world of cable, and there's probably 2,000 cable channels in the United States running 24 hours a day. That's a lot of content. That's a lot of demand for content. And there's 40,000 cable and satellite channels in the world running 24 hours a day. That's an enormous amount of material. Those channels need content. There's no point in owning a cable channel if you don't put something on the air. And right now, those cable channels are paying anywhere from $10,000 or $15,000 per half hour to $250,000 or more per half hour. If you can take your phone, and maybe you hook up with two or three of your friends, you can take your phone and you can create what they have on the channel already. They don't want you to reinvent the channel. But if you can create and deliver to them a product that is as good as the crew with the production company and the offices and the overhead and the researchers and all the crap, if you can undercut them and deliver a comparable or even better piece, then there's a niche for you to fill right now with your Mojo or VJ or whatever you want to call it. And beyond that, because the internet now allows it, if you can create a channel that delivers that quality of stuff, which is kind of another project we're trying to do, that's an even better and bit further down the road. So do not despair is my lesson here, but do not think that because you run around and make some cool piece of video and you got 100 or 1,000 or 10,000 likes, you're gonna be able to make a living out of it. Last I heard, landlords don't take likes for payment, and neither does Whole Foods. So I hope you found this interesting, and I hope you'll take a look at thevj.com. That's why we're doing this. Talk to you later. I hope you enjoyed that. And if you want to learn more and see more, come and see us at thevj.com. Is that right?